Hi, Dynamic Students. This is Dr. Dan Baker with another video today talking about the instantaneous centers of zero velocity, or ICZVs, for bodies that are in general plane motion. We'll go through a lot of those definitions, make sure we match things up. This is about a section 16.6 if we're using the Hibbler textbook. So the idea here is that an ICZV, in the most fundamental sense, it is equivalent to a fixed axis for a body in general plane motion. So while it's not a true fixed axis, and it actually moves over time, at one instant, we can find a point that the body is essentially rotating around. So another definition here, we could say that it is a point on or off a body in general plane motion. I'll go ahead and use that abbreviation here, right? General plane motion, GPM. Which the body is rotating around . And so because it's rotating around that point and because it acts like a fixed axis point, it has a zero velocity, right? Which comes right out of its definition here, its name, instantaneous center of zero velocity. Now, the cool thing about instantaneous centers of zero velocity, if we go back to our fundamental equation, velocity of B is equal to the velocity of A plus our omega of AB crossed with R of B relative to A, right? Our relative velocity equation, which came out of section 16.5, looking at rigid bodies in general plane motion using the relative velocity approach. So the cool thing here is that if this point, say point A, is an ICZV, then this velocity equals zero. So then we're left with, instead of a additive vector equation, we're left with an equation that looks exactly like the equations we use for fixed axis rotation, right? Where the body is rotating around a fixed axis point. So just to summarize that into words, we can say this is a parallel approach to relative velocity where we substitute additional geometry for one less velocity term. Is essentially this guy right here, right? We can set that one velocity equal to zero, but we do need to find out where that point is. Now, one little point, kind of the main definition of how we find these, and I'll go through some different rules. One point and how to find these, I'll additionally go through some rules. Specifically, we can say that all ICZVs are perpendicular to velocity vectors at greater than or equal to 2 points on a body. It turns out that we cannot find an ICZV unless we have 2 points of velocity on a body. But once you have 2 points, then we're off to the races. All right, so rule number one. That is that any point which touches a non-moving body and does not slip is a ICZB. So to give you a couple of examples of this, let's say that we have a wheel. This wheel is rolling down a surface, it can be a non-slip surface. And so if the ground isn't moving, then at this contact point right here, this has to be an ICZV because the ground has zero velocity and also the wheel at that point will have a zero velocity. So what we can do with that, if we know that's an ICZV, then we could locate, say, to the center here. If we know that this is my position vector to the center and I also have an omega, this wheel is rolling down the hill, I can end up finding here a velocity. It's called this point O. Velocity of point O going to the left, matching up with that omega, right? And all these velocities are going to be perpendicular. We could do another position vector here. Let's call this R2. Now this velocity vector will be perpendicular as well. Coming up this direction, call this V2, if this sphere was point two. Okay, so still crossing omega cross R is equal to our velocity. Now another application of this actually goes back to our particle motion topics. And this has to do with pulleys. This is actually my favorite technique to compute pulley problems. So let's take a look at a very simple pulley problem here. Let's say that we have this pulley, and it's kind of like a yo-yo, right? There's a cord wrapped around it, and let's say the velocity here is dropping downward, and you want to figure out the velocity of other points on this body. So as we think about points of zero velocity, I don't think it would be a big leap for many of you to think about this point up here as being a zero velocity point, right, where the rope is connected to the roof. But it turns out that this cable, because the top of it isn't moving, the bottom of it isn't moving either, because it's not stretching, it's not extending. So at this instant, we have a zero velocity point at this contact point. So if I draw a line across the middle, it turns out I can use these 2 points of zero velocity, one of them the ICZB, the other one here in the middle, and then I can actually draw a triangle showing a distribution of all the velocities across that center line. Right, so you can see if this was V, then this over here would be 2 times V because it's going to have twice the distance, its radius over to V, 2 times the radius of the diameter over to the far side. And so that would be another technique where we could use a non-slip zero velocity contact point to find an ICZV. Two more applications. We'll take a look at these next. So we have, we're going to call this rule number two. And this one has to do with parallel velocities. And so this rule states that if two parallel velocity vectors are perpendicular to the same line, we can connect the velocity vector tips to tips and tails to tails. The ICZV is at the intersection of these lines. All right, so what that would look like is if we have a rigid body, doesn't really matter the shape. So here we're gonna have two different points we're finding velocities of. Now, one key thing here is the velocities must be perpendicular to this same line, okay? So if this is V1, let's call this VA, call this point A. And then here, let's say that this is VB, call this point B. Then here's my tips to tips and tails to tails. Okay, so tails to tails already connected here along line AB. And then tips to tips, we come here on the diagonal and we find that our ICZV is at the intersection point between these lines. Now, we could additionally show the velocities don't have to be going in the opposite directions. They could be going in the same direction. Let's look at another situation here. So I'll call this C, call this D. Let's say that here is our velocity of C, and a shorter here, velocity of D. So here's my tail to tail. Continue this one down. Here's my tip to tip. We find out that our ICZV is down here toward the bottom. And so this also comes to show that we can have ICZVs that are either on the body or off the body, depending on the orientation of those velocity vectors. And noting in all these cases, the velocity is perpendicular to this line that we use to find ICZV. All right, so the last rule, we'll call this rule number 3, has to do with non-parallel velocities. So this is for non-parallel velocities. And so this one's a little simpler. We can just say that given two non-parallel velocities, we want to extend perpendicular lines to find our ICZV at the intersection. So this could look, so here's our rigid body, here is point A, here is point B. Adding some velocities, let's say we have a velocity going up here, BA, VB. let's go over this direction. So each individual vector, you'll extend a perpendicular line to that velocity. And the same thing here for VB. In this case, it's not very far away. So this point of intersection between them will be the IC ZV. So it turns out that this last one, quite honestly, is the one that gets used a lot in general plane motion systems, as in like solving four-bar linkages and different things like that, as compared to these other two get used quite a bit for pulley problems and maybe some other problems like rolling wheels and those types of things. But these are the three basic rules. There are some other rules that are out there, but these are the three that are most common. I hope that helps you visualize the basics here of ICZVs, and we'll come back with a later video showing their application.